Well, I guess maybe if you stick around long enough, you might actually get something done. So I've been around quite a long time now. I actually started my forestry career when I was 16 years old, working on a fire crew for the Washington Department of Natural Resources. That was back in 1953. So I've had quite a long time to be able to get out in the woods and learn about it. And of course, had a whole lot of time to think about how those forests work and how we might incorporate more of those natural processes in our active management. That's what I'm really going to be talking with you about today. Forestry globally really is taking two very different tracks. One of them is what I'm going to refer to as production forestry, and it certainly derives from the historic focus of foresters on wood production, but it is a much more directed form than forestry was in the old days, and primarily it follows an agronomic model. It's basically about growing wood fiber as a crop and doing it in a very efficient fashion. On the other hand, the other fork in the road is one of what I'm going to be calling ecological forestry, which is based on natural models, natural forest processes, in which we try to really look at forests and how they work and incorporate that into our management activities in order to achieve a much broader array of goals. We're not interested in ecological forestry and maximizing any single output. In fact, we sort of recognize the principle that any time you try to manage a complex system like a forest or maximizing a single output, you're almost certainly going to marginalize or eliminate other values. And as it turns out, the majority of the forest global estate is really going to be managed in some way to sustain a whole array of goods and services rather than trying to maximize any single one of those. And that's what ecological forestry is about. I've been working with it for a number of people now for several decades. One of those folks is, of course, Brian Palak over at Grand Rapids. One of the great contributors to it was a fellow by the name of Bob Mitchell, ecologist and silviculturist down in the longleaf pine. And I've worked a lot in recent years with Dr. K. Norman Johnson and his wife, Deborah Johnson, who's also a forester, in developing really the details of ecologically based forest management. We're just in the process of completing a textbook. We'll be delivering a textbook called Ecological Forest Management to the publisher probably within the next month. And so we're really trying to begin to deepen and systematize these concepts. And of course, we've had a whole variety of names for it over the years. I started probably 35 years ago now, calling it, in the time of the elder bush, a kinder and gentler forestry. And it certainly is a kinder and gentler forestry than production forestry today. But anyway, start by looking at a natural forest system here. Incidentally, this is a deep, dark, dank, decadent, old-growth forest. Doesn't live up to its reputation at all, does it? You know, that's on the Olympic Peninsula. Let's see here. Okay, we're going to be talking today about ecological forest management. And basically, you're going to be interested in ecological forest management for a number of reasons, but these are two of the most important ones. And that is, you know, society really has developed some very different kinds of objectives that they're interested in with regards to forests. We're also, of course, we've dramatically expanded our knowledge base about these systems. And one of the things I've come to realize in writing this textbook is that, in fact, a matter, the old forester, way back in the first half of the 20th century, couldn't even have conceived of the kind of forestry we've talked about today, because we didn't have the kind of knowledge about forests as ecosystems that we do today. And so that expansion in science is really significant, and it has very much interacted with society. Leopold has a comment on this, one of his many comments in his writing. He talks about how, you know, once you know about something, you can begin to appreciate and value something. And until we really begin to develop our knowledge of forests as ecosystems and not just collections of trees, we really couldn't appreciate many aspects of the system. And we certainly do now. So both of these have been great drivers. And always, you know, forestry is a social science before it is anything else. And all of the most profound changes in forestry have been the result of social changes, not primarily because of either the increased knowledge or, in fact, changes in the environment. And that's going to be true in this century as well. As profound as climate change is going to be, the more dynamic element in the forester's environment is going to be that of society and what they want. So here's where we started out. You know, this is where I started out in forestry, very much a wood focus. And if you look at the old tenets of the forester, you know, wood really was the primary goal. But we've gotten interested in a whole bunch of other things now. We're interested in biological diversity. We'll go back to that. There's a little bit of a delay in this, so it'll take me a minute here to figure out how to do this. But I want to go back. I can't go back. What we were interested in was certainly a production orientation, but we've become very interested in biological diversity. And we've become very interested as well in the other functions that a forest system serves, including, of course, protection of watersheds, which is water and the influence of forest systems on water is probably the most important single functional attribute of forests in this century. Certainly it's going to be more important than that of wood production. So if your goal is in fact one of trying to sustain a whole array of values rather than a single one, then you really sort of have to back off and start thinking about how these natural systems work. And this has been a significant force as we developed ecological forestry, because we really began by trying to tweak traditional concepts and traditional practices. And it turns out that is not sufficient to really get you to where you need to go. And you need to ultimately go back and think afresh about these forest systems and how they worked. And that's going to be your primary source of information to develop these practices. We're going to really need them wherever we want to, in fact, integrate a whole range of objectives, ecologic or environmental, economic, and cultural. Certainly going to use it a lot where we want to restore systems. And in general, you know, what we really are going to be needing to do in this very uncertain 21st century is think about ways that we can manage these forests that will reduce risks and increase options. And so much of what we've done in forestry has just been the opposite in that. Well, production forestry is a very much a risk-taking operation and one that in fact closes out options rather than creates options. And that's the way, in fact, our capitalist world works. These are risk takers that are driving that system. And we want to be much more conservative, I think, on many of our lands and certainly on our public forest lands. Production forestry, as I indicated, if you're really interested in efficient production of wood with primarily the goal of a certain return on capital, then production forestry is going to be very applicable. It's an agronomically based approach. It isn't based on forestry. It's based on agriculture. Growing wood fiber is a crop. And there is a constraint on that, and that is the economic constraint of return on capital. Because TIMOs and REITs are really basically capital generating mechanisms. Their goal really is not wood production as such, only wood as a means to an end. That said, basically most of the time, these organizations using productive and forestry approaches will operate within the constraints of the law and probably also with concern for the long-term sustainability of the site. Although remember, a TIMO and a REIT is not really committed to that site, either as a forest or as a long-term investment. It is a temporary phenomenon. Ecological forestry, and basically the second chapter in our textbook is all about this, is about ecosystems. And again, you know, I have a great deal of sympathy and appreciation for the old forester, the old wildlife manager, the old fisheries biologist, because basically they were very focused on certain outcomes, whether it was wood or whether it was wildlife that you could shoot. But part of that was because they did not have a broader perspective on their systems. And as they began to get that, we began to realize other concerns that we had with regards to those. And I consider that when Leopold was talking about the land, he was really talking about the ecosystem. And the land is the term that he put on it. And I suspect he did that partly because ecosystem wasn't an accepted concept in his time, but also because it would imply a larger spatial perspective than some people think about when you say ecosystem to them. Okay, so in any case, three fundamental attributes of ecosystems are composition, structure, and function. And what I do in chapter two of this book is to go through and to try to really lay out the basics of those attributes so that a forest manager or anyone else interested in managing such a system has an appreciation for it in terms of what it does and how it's built and how it does that. Obviously, composition of the biota, the organisms that are present, and it isn't just a list of species, it is very much the interactions of those species. It is also one element of that interaction is certainly the food webs, the who eats who. And I've become particularly appreciative of that, which I hadn't been, in thinking about the early successional kinds of ecosystems which have such rich and complex food webs, and is one of the reasons why those systems tend to have very high diversity. Function, of course, all forest systems are working forests. It isn't just forests that are managed for wood production that are working forests. All forest systems, in fact, all natural systems, are doing work that we care about very selfishly as human beings. And the kinds of functions that we think about are those that have to do with the production system. That's about energy or carbon or biomass, whatever you want to call it, which of course has at its base green plants, because photosynthesis is in fact the way in which energy is acquired by these systems. And of course, it is that energy which sustains all of the elements in the systems. So we're talking in that case, all of the functions related to the capture of sun's energy and its ultimate utilization in the ecosystem. Second major category is, of course, the interaction of forest systems with the hydrologic processes. I hesitate to call it a cycle because on the scale of a forest, it isn't really a cycle. It's more of a flow through. And obviously, you know, forests are probably the most important single ecosystem we have in terms of regulating our flows of water. Profoundly important in a variety of ways. And nothing could be more important in this century than a well-regulated supply of high-quality water. That's fundamental to any civilization. Obviously, that includes snow as well as water. You know that better than I do. You live in Houghton. A third functional category has to do with the nutrient cycles and the other material cycles and systems. And of course, again, forests and natural systems play a huge role. And interestingly, almost all natural systems are basically accumulators of organic matter and nutrients. This isn't 100% true, but for the most part, they all are, in fact, netting out an excess in terms of accumulating under their natural processes, organic materials and nutrients. And then a fourth category of function, which has been added by ecosystem science in recent years, the provision of habitat for biological diversity. The provision of habitat. And that's a valid functional attribute of ecosystems these days. And anyone who's tried to manage, for example, for a threatened and endangered species knows about what we're talking about with regards to that. But of course, that set of species is only a tiny percent of all of the species that are really out there that these systems are sustaining. The third attribute, category of attributes, is structure. That's what I've spent most of my life on. And that's what most foresters spend most of their life on, because it's about things like trees, okay? And very much, you know, structure is about the architecture of a system, the pieces of that system, and the way in which they're spatially arranged. And so, you know, that's what we're doing all the time in forestry. We're adding to or subtracting from those pieces, and we're rearranging the way they are in the forest system. So that's really what we're about. And structure is a really good surrogate for a whole bunch of things. For one thing, you know, it's a really good surrogate for habitat. We often use it for that. We often use structure as a measure of some of the functions that we can't measure very well directly, like production. Also, of course, structure itself is often a product that we're interested in. So basically, you know, I try in that chapter to lay this out very briefly and in relatively simple terms. My feedback on people that have looked at the chapter is, wow, this is pretty dense. But, you know, you're going to summarize, you know, basically an overview of the ecosystem concept. It is going to get dense. Now, there are a couple of things in this chapter that's important to this audience. One of them is that, oh, damn, we foresters have learned that a tree when it dies is no longer an object without value ecologically. We've learned dead wood is important. And, you know, this this was really a tough thing for foresters to begin to deal with, because before that, the whole notion was, gosh, when a tree's dead, it doesn't matter, we can take it, right? No problem. It's not serving an ecological function. No, it absolutely is. And so one of the things I emphasize in that chapter is that it isn't just the live tree, it's also the tree after it dies. All of the derivatives, the snags, the down logs, the other coarse woody debris. It's fundamentally important. And you can't manage a forest ecologically without providing for some aspects of that. The other thing, which is, I think, unique to our book, is old trees are important. Now, I've never seen a silvicultural text where it talked about old trees and old trees being important. But old trees are important. Now, you know, if old trees were just small trees enlarged, that'd be a piece of cake, because we can grow big trees, you know, if that's all you need. But in fact, a matter, we're concerned often with old trees because they provide unique habitat. They provide unique niches in our forest systems. They provide niches that can't be provided in any other way. So many, many of the times that we're going to be managing forests ecologically, we're going to be trying to, in fact, either create or sustain populations of some older trees. Not necessarily dominated the forest, but certainly is a component of the forest. And we've never talked about that in silviculture before, but we have to begin to talk about it now. In terms of then thinking about natural processes that we might use as models for what we're going to do out there, it's really disturbances and stand dynamics. In terms of stand development, that is where we're really going to find the ideas, the approaches that we can use in ecological forestry. And the first one of these is disturbances, and thinking about disturbances in very different ways. And for us, you know, for me and for many of us, Mount St. Helens eruption in May 1980 was an epiphany. It was where we really had our eyes opened. And we had believed that the area was essentially a moonscape, and that everything was going to have to return to the area from outside. And what we learned at Mount St. Helens was it wasn't a moonscape at all. It was full of organisms that had survived and persisted through that complex of disturbances, as intense as they were, and played major roles in the process of development of the post-disturbance ecosystem. And just a couple of examples, that those silver fir trees that you see growing there survived the eruption. They were buried in snowbanks. That's how they got through it. There were all kinds of weedy communities dominated by things like fireweed in the landscape on areas that had been clear cut prior to the eruption. And they essentially were pre-adapted weedy communities that just took a hit and came right back again. And so basically what we discovered was that that landscape that we flew over and saw in shades of green, gray, black, brown, believed to be essentially a moonscape, turned out to be very much alive. And in addition to that, there was a lot of dead organic material around. And a lot of that dead organic material was in the form of things like logs and snags. And, you know, that's not just a source, a long-term source of energy and nutrients. It is that. But because of the nature of these accumulations of dead organic material, these structures, you know, powerful in terms of their interaction with various physical processes like erosion and deposition, and also very, very significant is habitat. Places, you know, that people could, critters, organisms of various kinds could survive, grow, provide habitat, create cavities, and so forth. Now, all of this experience at Mount St. Helens made us go back and think again about other natural disturbances. And it's interesting how it takes a really big event sometimes to remind you of what you already knew. And that's what it did for us. And when you think about fire, for example, fire rarely consumes very much of the dead organic material, much of the organic material. Basically, it kills trees, but it leaves most of it behind, even the most intense fire. And this stand replacement fire, you'll notice, even had surviving mature green trees left in it. So I was taught as a forestry student that clear cutting was just like a wildfire. Does this look like a clear cut? No, it doesn't. And it's because, you know, we had that lack of appreciation of the importance of the big wood. A wind throw event doesn't remove anything from the site. All it does is lay down the overstory trees and release everything that's in the understory. And no organic materials leave the site at all. So incredible legacies, incredible persistence of elements of the pre-disturbance ecosystem. Same with insect outbreaks. And the bottom line here is that most natural disturbances, basically you kill trees, but you don't remove or consume most of the organic material. And we decided we'd call those biological legacies. And they come in both living and dead form, and they also come in the form of spatial patterns. I'm not going to go into detail on that, on any aspect of it, other than to say sometimes the legacies are very large and very long-lasting. So this is a diagram that shows, you know, the tremendous pulse of wood that's shifted from live to dead after a stand replacement fire in an old-growth forest. And that pulse of dead material, of big dead wood, is what the system lives off of for the next 100 to 150 years in our Doug fir hemlock systems. So very persistent, and it means that the young forest is loaded with big wood. It's a very structurally complex system, just as the old growth forest is. It also reminds us that there is a midpoint, and we're going to call it a mature stage of development, when wood is at a very low level because it's rotted away much of the initial pulse, but hasn't really started feeding back big wood back into the system again. And again, just to put an exclamation mark on persistence, this is a 125-year-old stand of Douglas fir, and we still have a totally intact standing dead cedar tree, and then another one that's just fallen over after it finally rotted away at the ground. That legacy is going to persist for probably 300 to 500 years unless another fire comes back. And we can understand how different kinds of disturbances are going to produce different kinds of legacies. And of course, of the different kinds of disturbances that we're familiar with, clear cuts essentially leave no significant legacies behind. You know, regardless of how we foresters have tried to tweak clear cutting in various ways so we can say it's you know, not really a clear cut anymore. A clear cut, by the traditional definition, we in fact try to remove any evidence of the pre-existing forest. That's our goal. So that then is an aspect of the disturbance and the kinds of legacies that it creates that we want to think about as we go about manipulating forests. The other, again, has to do with the stand development that goes on. And I'm going to try to quickly run through this, but In chapter three of the book, we not only talk about disturbances, but then lay out a very simple set of stages that probably almost everybody in their forest system should be able to relate to and provide you with building blocks that you can begin to think about in terms of different periods of stand development. So, and I'm going to start with Douglas fir forests here, which are forests that are episodically disturbed at highly infrequent intervals and go on to develop for very long time periods, certainly several centuries. Now I call this whole thing, this whole developmental sequence, a sear. And like I said, you know, we've sort of developed a very simplified scheme. This was an earlier scheme that had more complexity in it. And it's just going to boil down really to a pre-forest stage, a young forest, a mature forest, and an old forest. And if you can understand those four stages, you can begin to understand what it is we need to be creating and thinking about as we go about doing ecological forest management. It does begin with a disturbance of some kind, and we have to think about, of course, the legacies that we choose to leave behind to become a part of that new seer. And one of the things we have really had to begin to think seriously about was the pre-forest stage. Now, you know, traditionally, we foresters have only viewed this period as one that was to be simply endured because we can't get it fully restocked with trees the year after we harvest it. Truly, you know, that is what we would have wished to do in most cases, but we can't. So what we've referred to it as is, you know, the regeneration phase or the tree establishment phase, as though that's the only thing important that's happening in this period of time after a disturbance and before canopy closure occurs again. Okay? Well, it turns out that period of time in which you have an open condition, meaning a condition that is not dominated by the tree life form, is extraordinarily important, and particularly for us in the Northwest, because we have such long periods of dominance by evergreen conifer forests. And basically, this is a period of time that's characterized by very plant life form diverse communities. Basically, these are communities that are dominated by shrubs and herbs and some trees and other kinds of plants. And these are very, very rich systems in terms of biological diversity. Call them, you know, the early successional stage. What I decided to do ultimately in the book was call it the pre-forest stage. That tells you it is a site that you eventually expect forest to come back in, but it is not dominated by the tree life form. And that's the really important thing. And this is a period of time in which you're going to have a whole lot of biological diversity. I'll probably come back to that. But I'll simply say that the most biologically rich period in the development of our northwestern conifer forest is the pre-forest period. Richer by far than the old growth forest system. And it's not primarily composed of weeds or generalist. It's composed primarily of species that are, guess what, early successional habitat specialists. And a lot of them are things we care about, like, in fact, neotropical migrant birds and a lot of our butterflies and moths. So we care about that stage in succession. And again, it was an epiphany that came out of Mount St. Helens, which is the most biologically diverse region in the Pacific Northwest. Canopy closure, I'm not going to say a whole lot about that, but when it does happen, of course, it totally alters the system. The forest becomes very dark and closed, and we enter a period of intense competition, not only among the tree life form, but between the trees and any other plant life form as well. And these tend to be very, very simple systems. They tend to be very low in biological diversity. If you're going to live in a closed canopy conifer forest, you damn well better be something that either is a detritivore or eats detritivores. Okay? Because otherwise, there just isn't going to be much food available for you. The other way you can make a living is being a seed eater. But it is a period of time in which you have incredibly rapid biomass accumulation. So that's our young forest. That's the forest that the production foresters love, exponential kind of growth, intense competition, and profoundly competitively based competition, which has several distinctive characteristics. One of them is that it's highly predictable. It's going to be the smaller trees in the stand. Second thing, it's going to be the most intense where the stand is densest. And the third thing is that that density-dependent nature of this process is going to tend to create a more uniform stand. This is the only time in the entire development of this forest in which you see nature moving a forest towards greater homogeneity. And it's only going to last as long as the young forest stage. Forest looks something like that in the Douglas fir region. And again, I want to emphasize, you know, the nature, the importance of the type of dominant mortality process in this stand. Foresters love it. It's highly predictable. Now, eventually, that young forest is going to begin to relax. And basically, in the old forestry terminology, it would reach culmination of mean annual increment. It would become overmature. In fact, it's only become mature at that point in time and has a really extensive period of development to go through, during which it's going to transition into an old forest. And in a very broad sense, you can think of the maturation stage of forest development as being a transition from the young forest and its nature to an old forest and its nature. Now that's not a very insightful thing to say, but that's the way it actually works. The understory reestablishes in this stage. The pioneer cohort tends to mature. Woody debris is very low. But the really key thing that happens now is that the patterns of mortality begin to shift. And so we begin to get mortality due to insects, bark beetles, for example. We begin to get mortality due to butt and root rots. We begin to get mortality related to wind throw. And what's happening then is we're beginning to get significant ancient agent-based mortality, wind, insects, disease, which is also spatially aggregated, and which is also killing larger trees, and incidentally is almost totally unpredictable. It's very, very difficult to predict who's going to die in one of these forests, because from our perspective, much of it almost looks to be random in nature. Probably not, but it looks that way at times. And of course, what it's now doing is producing gaps, holes in the canopy, with the consequence that you get a whole lot of response from things in the understories, like some of the intermediate or more shade-tolerant species that now have access to more light and really begin to develop and grow into the overstory canopy. It's a cross-section of a real stand that's in that kind of a maturing stage of development. The old forest stage is the last one of the three, and it differs very fundamentally in nature from particularly the young forest. Overall increase in patchiness, tremendous amount of decadence, abundant development of various kinds of unique features that go with older trees like epicormic branches, and a strong representation of shade tolerance as co-dominance in the canopy. And the forest looks like this. One of the interesting things is the mean diameter of this stand may be rather similar to that of a 40 or 50 year old plantation. But the difference is, of course, the mean the range and diameter of the trees in the stand is huge. And in fact, we often use the range and tree diameter as one of the attributes that we use in our old growth indices. Tremendous amount of woody debris in these systems. This is when we again accumulate very large stocks of woody debris on the forest floor, and also, of course, there's a lot of dead wood in the form of snags in these systems. And we have a continuing development and filling of various kinds of canopy openings, such as we're looking down on here. And of course, we get appropriate kinds of responses in the understory. And we get a totally different canopy architecture. And this tends to be true of very old hardwood stands as well as our old conifer stands. And that is that basically the notion of, you know, this smooth overlapping canopy that we had in the young forest, gone. Basically, what you have instead is a very rugose canopy in which you have these big individual trees basically standing up, producing these mountains, and then these deep valleys or canopies or canopy gaps in the system in which you get deep light penetration. And so what we find, in fact, in the old forest is the canopy, instead of being top-loaded as it once was in the young forest, is now bottom-loaded. And I like to relate, you know, to the nature of the physique of human males. We sort of have this shift topographically from being top-loaded to being bottom-loaded. That's what the old forest does through a very interesting array of processes. And then this stand, this is a real forest, this is a LIDAR image showing the distribution of foliage. Basically, you go to the top of this forest, which is about 65 meters, the top of the tallest tree, you come halfway to the ground, and you've only encountered 20% of the foliage in that. And so 80% of the foliage is in the bottom half, and in fact, the vast majority of the foliage is in the bottom 30% of that canopy. So we've flipped everything on its head through the stand development process. And of course, in this old stand, we do have, of course, very large old trees, which again have very rich array of niches, habitats, which are not available. And also, you know, have a number of other very distinctive attributes, like, for example, a great deal more heartwood. And, of course, much thicker barks, which are very significant in terms of habitat and in terms of resistance to things like fire. And here's, you know, an example of some of the epicormic branch formation. But we get brooms, multiple tops, reiterated canopies, all kinds of things. Which provide, you know, really great canopy habitats that are not otherwise available. These epicormic branches, for example, on Doug firs are perfect sites for things like northern spotted owls and marbled murrelets. And so here's just a couple of cross sections of old stands. Now, the end point of development of episodically disturbed forests, and it's as true in deciduous forests as it is in coniferous forests, is you're going to have, you know, an extremely heterogeneous old growth forest stage with a wide variety of structures. And essentially what you're going to have is a system that is maintained in kind of a dynamic series of canopy openings and developments by chronic disturbance processes, wind, rots, insects. Maintaining this as a dynamic within-stand continuing process of development and enrichment. And that's just simply going to go on then until you get another kind of disturbance. Now, so you can probably relate to that kind of forest. You have those kinds of forests, and you can take those four stages, pre-forest, young, mature, and old, and you can see them in various forms repeated over and over again in different forest types. And if you keep it simple like that, you can play games with those and build models that sort of fit many of our forest systems. But there's another category of forest, and why foresters didn't recognize, you know, right on page one of the textbooks, you know, I don't know. They should have on page one said, you know, there are two kinds of forests. They're episodically disturbed forests and there are frequent fire forests. The frequent fire forests are a totally different ball game, even though we've tried to ignore that in forestry. And so when we think about ecological forestry, we can't ignore it anymore. We have to recognize that forests subject to frequent low to moderate intensity fire are fundamentally different wherever you find them in the world. And what happens if you send fire into a forest frequently? Every 2 or 3 years or every 5 or 10 years or even every 20 or 30 years, what are you going to do? Well, you're constantly, fire is going to be selecting against any fire-sensitive species, right? So you're going to be essentially preferentially developing a forest which is dominated by fire-tolerant species. Can't work any other way. In the process of that, and the fact that you're sending fire frequently through a system, consuming fuels, and of course killing small trees, the smaller the tree, the more likely you are to get killed by the process, you're going to tend to produce more savanna-like forest systems, more open forest systems. Now, that has to be the case. You can't have frequent fire if you don't have a lot of fine fuels. You got to have a system that's open enough to sustain a ground cover that will provide for frequent fire. And you end up with a savanna-like forest dominated by larger and older trees because it's just occasionally that one of these survives and breaks through to a condition where it's totally, almost totally invulnerable to fire. Well-developed understories and a tendency for them to be patchworks or mosaics. Where's the bookend of a system like that? That's longleaf pine. It is the bookend system for frequent fire forests. And it requires forests at an interval of every 1 to 3 years. And if it doesn't get it, it begins to change into something else. So here's our bookend. And it is extremely characteristic of essentially most frequent fire systems. It's a consequence, again, of frequent low-intensity fire, which is selecting to produce, in fact, a forest which is composed of this very fire-tolerant species. And of course, longleaf is just beautifully adapted to this, because it has this grass stage in which it sits for a period of time as regeneration. Now, I can't pass through longleaf without also noting it is the most biologically rich temperate forest system I know of. Don't know anyone more than that. The understory of these forests basically can have anywhere from 400 to 550 species in them. Now, incredibly diverse incredibly rich understories. And one way of thinking about these, and again, remember, you need to have that in order to provide the fuels that will sustain the frequent fire regime. I worked with a wonderful old forester down there. God bless him. For years, he had carried on ecological forest management in an area where you were absolutely ridiculed if you didn't do plantation forestry with southern pine. But he said, Jerry, said you just need to understand that what this is a tall grass prairie with some pine trees stuck in it. And that's just a beautiful way of thinking about these systems. Now, of course, we have a lot of frequent fire forests, or what were frequent fire forests in the western United States, in the Intermountain West, in the Sierra Nevadas. And, of course, the productivity is much lower. Fire frequency is much less. But basically, we end up with, again, that same kind of architecture, which isn't to say all of the forest was like this, but this is basically the tendency of a frequent fire system, is to move towards this kind of a structure. Based on frequent fire, and again, these systems tend to be structural mosaics. They tend to have different structural conditions, but very fine scale, low contrast differences amongst them. 5 minutes? Okay. Well, I'm going to just then whiz right through here. Obviously, you know, we've had some problems in the West with closing out fire. And this is Treebeard. For those of you who know anything about Tolkien. And so what does Treebeard and these natural forests have to tell us in terms of our silvicultural practices? Well, basically, what we're going to do in ecological forestry is we're going to incorporate these things that we understand about natural stand development. We're going to incorporate legacies. And we are also going to think about ecologically appropriate time intervals between silvicultural treatments. And there are four principles in the silviculture chapter. This is a forest management textbook. We're also writing a silvicultural textbook. Brian Palak's a senior author on that. It'll be a year after this before we get that done. But basically, I had to write a chapter on silviculture for this forest management textbook in terms of explaining what our principles are. And the principles basically are very simple. And I'm just going to skip over the stool here. Basically, there are three stand level principles and a fourth landscape level principle for silviculture using ecological forestry. First principle, and it's all about biological legacies and it's all about retention, is that we are going to provide for continuity in structure, function, and composition between forest generations. That's what biological legacies are really about. It's about continuity in terms of structure, function, and composition, not discontinuity, which is what we do with even age management. So we're going to do that. And that's what retention is going to be about. We're going to keep things when we harvest. We are not going to clear cut. We're going to be doing various kinds of partial cutting regimes that leave significant elements of the old forest behind. We're going to secondly use natural models in basically developing approaches to management that create and sustain structural complexity and biological richness. We're going to be after both of those objectives. And third, we're going to be thinking about ecologically appropriate intervals. And that doesn't necessarily mean long rotations. It does mean appropriate intervals. And sometimes it means things like thinking about where you got to go quickly, like longleaf pine and fire. The fourth is the landscape level principle. You do nothing in ecological forestry without planning and implementing it at larger spatial scales. Okay? And I'm going to finish up simply with how we envision the ecological forestry landscape. I'll just quickly go past some pictures here because I want to get to one particular. That's retention. That's kind of retention. That's retention. That's both dispersed and aggregated retention. That, incidentally, is a Washington DNR's application of variable retention harvesting with about 30% retention. But I want to get down here. That's 40% aggregated retention. Oh, darn. I wished I could just scroll ahead, but I can't. The thinning that we do, incidentally, is very different from what we do in commercial thinning. In fact, we often will be thinning in ways to create heterogeneity and thinning from above. Okay, I'm almost to where I want to be. Sorry. Okay. A little diatribe against the academic conservation biologist and the old forester. I'm going to shoot them both. Okay. The traditional view of a conservation biologist is based on island biogeographic theory. The whole concept here is that terrestrial habitat is like islands in an ocean, except what we have is islands of habitat embedded in a landscape that is composed entirely of non-habitat. The terrestrial world is divided into habitat and non-habitat. So they have a very black and white vision of the world, where maybe the black here are the ecological reserves and the white is the rest of them. Okay. So that's kind of the traditional conservation biology perspective. That's certainly E.O. Wilson's perspective. You know, E.O. would tell you the only way to conserve biological diversity is with ecological reserves. Now, the old forester sort of looked at it this way, too. So when I talked to the chief of the Forest Service back in 1983 about biodiversity, he said, oh, no problem. We'll just have to set aside a few more biological reserves, then we can do what we want in the rest of the landscape. So my point to you is, if in fact, as the conservation biologist or the chief of the Forest Service thought about this landscape as being black and white, habitat and not habitat, if that's what you think, that is what you will create with your management. Because you think you've done the job of conserving diversity in your preserves, you don't have to worry about it anyplace else in the landscape. That, I would argue, is a sure potential for failure. We will not conserve biological diversity or ecosystem processes that way. And in black and white, what we really want is a landscape that is shades of gray. And in ecological forestry, where we're in color, basically we want to think in terms of shades of green. So in ecological forestry, one of the important visions of the landscape is one in which all parts of that landscape contribute to ecological function and the maintenance of biological diversity. I'll just end on that note. So.
Running out of time, so I was going to suggest that we maybe take one or two questions, very quick questions. Do remember that Jerry is going to be talking again tomorrow at 12 o'clock up in the MEM building. And there is also the social tonight, so you will get an opportunity to talk to him tonight if you come to that. So are there one or two very quick questions? Yeah, Ken.
Creating these shades of green, it's going to take a lot of social science. What are your basic recommendations in integrating sociocultural aspects of forest management?
Well, I think actually it works very well with regards to both social and cultural principles. Absolutely, I believe that, you know, forestry is a social science and it has to be accepted. But in fact of the matter, what I find with a lot of audiences, including people in small communities, rural areas, they do not like production forest. They find that it creates a very hostile environment, and for the most part, they don't particularly care for it except for the fact that it provides jobs. Okay? They care about anything that. Most people, in fact, prefer to have a landscape where they sense that it's all in some way provided, contributing to ecological functions. And certainly the Native American populations tend to feel that way. So I think once people understand what it is you're trying to do, that the potential for social acceptance is very high. And you can dial this, a little more towards economics or a little more towards conservation, just depending on who you are, what land base you're working with, etc. And the most difficult thing that I've had to deal with in the public sector is that they don't like the openings. Okay? Currently, people tend to prefer park-like forests. And the whole notion that I need to create some significant openings to provide the habitat required by early successional species basically doesn't go down well with a lot of people. So that's where the education has to take place, just as we had to educate the university of USFS. I'm not worried about that in the long term. This feels better. People know it feels better. Yeah.
So ecologically, this is preferred, the shades of green, and you're arguing that socially we're on our way. But in the Pacific Northwest, the infrastructure they have, is it economically viable?
Absolutely is economically viable. And first, absolutely is, because we're talking about significant volumes of wood potentially be harvested. Let's talk about the federal lands in the Northwest, and let's talk about what Norm and I have proposed for the federal lands. We've talked about basically doing a variable retention harvesting and previously harvested stands that are plantations that are 50 to 70 years old. So that's what we've talked about doing. Those would be extremely profitable kinds of operations, and done correctly would provide us with exactly the kind of habitat that we want for the early succession species. Currently, on the federal lands in the Pacific Northwest, there is no regeneration harvest. No regeneration. The only thing they do is thin today. In the National Forest of the Pacific. And the Doug Fernand. Yeah, so this would be wow, real stick. For people that you can get on it. I apologize, I didn't edit myself properly to talk about the details of variable density thinning or variable retention harvesting, but I am going to talk with the students about that. I'm going to have a chance to go into it. But the kind of thinnings that you would do incidentally with ecological forestry are also more
more profitable than traditional commercial things. Because we're going to be doing ecological stuff, so we're sometimes going to be thinning from the bottom because we want something to happen down in the canopy. Thanks. It's fun to talk about.